Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be discussing specifically the internal pelvic viscera associated with an individual assigned female at birth, and you will see the abbreviation AFAB, which is going to be short for assigned female at birth. So those physical attributes in the form of viscera, which have more traditionally been referred to as biologically or genetically female viscera. Now, I want to note that the terminology that you will hear throughout the curriculum will vary, and concepts of sex and gender merit much more than what we're going to discuss here. Our anatomy team understand that neither sex or gender may be divisible binarily, and we hope to use terminology that is the most inclusive and appropriate. We are always learning and always appreciative of respectful and constructive feedback. All right, so let's get right into our mission, which is to best understand the gross anatomy, but also the relationships of the internal pelvic viscera and the important fascial and peritoneal ligaments in this region. So this is going to be a little bit longer of a video, so we have much to cover. Let's get started, and we're going to start with the uterine tubes, very, very often referred to as the fallopian tubes. Note, anatomical terminology has moved away from using eponyms, particularly for viscera associated with the reproductive system, but it often persists in other disciplines, and we will always present those that are particularly persistent, like the fallopian tube. So make sure you understand that uterine tubes and fallopian tubes are the same thing. The uterine tubes are a bit what they sound like. They are a tube that is going to provide a pathway from the ovary to the uterus for the oocytes. So they'll be released from the ovaries and then they will move into the uterine tubes. Note, uterine tubes are actually intraperitoneal, as is most of the internal pelvic viscera in this region. And that's something that's very often forgotten, is that peritoneum will extend this inferiorly. Regions like the bladder and the rectum will be more subperitoneal, but the uterine tubes, the ovaries, the uterus will be intraperitoneal. There are four major parts of the uterine tube. Starting laterally, there is the infundibulum, which is going to be this general region right here. The infundibulum is supposedly trumpet-shaped, and this opens into the abdominopelvic cavity via what is called the abdominal ostium. And it's through this region that the oocyte will enter the uterine tubes with guidance from these mucosal finger-shaped folds, which you can see kind of throughout this illustration here. And these are going to be attached to the distal end of the infundibulum. I always kind of think of these gently moving and directing the oocyte into the uterine tube. The next portion is going to be the longest and widest, even though it doesn't look particularly so in this illustration, and that is going to be the ampulla. And if fertilization occurs, it is most likely to occur in the lumen of the ampulla. This is going to be continuous with the isthmus, which is the narrowest part. It appears kind of rounded and firm in this portion. And of course, as its name would suggest, the uterine part is going to be the portion that actually lies in the myometrium of the uterus leading into the uterine cavity. If there is going to be some type of occlusion or closing of this region that's referred to as tubal ligation, sometimes you hear it referred to as tubes tied, that prevents passage of the oocyte. All right, very closely related to the infundibulum and the lateral pelvic walls are the ovaries, which are gonads that develop oocytes, as well as have an endocrine function, specifically secreting estrogen and progesterone. The ovaries are going to be composed of the cortex, medulla, and interstitial cells. The cortex contains the ovarian follicles at various stages of development. All right, next let's discuss the uterus, which is located medial to both the uterine tubes and the ovaries. And it's going to be this very prominent, thick-walled muscular organ. It's going to be located intermediate in position between the bladder and the rectum. There are two major parts. The upper third is going to be referred to as the body of the uterus. And note this part of the body that's actually superior to where those uterine tubes enter, so this region right here, is actually referred to as the fundus of the uterus. The lower third of the uterus is referred to as the cervix, and it's going to be narrower, it's going to be less muscular and more fibrous in terms of composition. The upper end of the cervix communicates with the uterine body via the internal os, and the lower end of the cervix opens into the vagina at the external os. The superior border of the uterus is covered with peritoneum, and peritoneal folds actually extend laterally from the uterus and surrounding structures as the broad ligament. And so the broad ligament's a very prominent structure in this region. We'll talk more about that in a moment. The surgical removal of the uterus is referred to as a hysterectomy. The vagina is a fibromuscular tube that extends from the cervix all the way to the vestibule of the vagina at the vaginal orifice. Sometimes you see it referred to as the ostium of the vagina. The superior portion of the vagina is going to surround the protrusion of the cervix into the vagina. So you can see that a bit right here. And this creates a recess between the cervix and the vagina, referred to as the fornix. And the different parts are given, the different parts of the fornix are given different or separate names, such as anterior, right and left lateral, and posterior vaginal fornices. Of particular clinical importance is going to be the posterior vaginal fornix, which you can see right in this region here. This will be the posterior vaginal fornix. This is going to offer access to the rectouterine pouch. So that's going to be that lowest extent or the most inferior extent of the peritoneum in the pelvis. So allowing access to the peritoneal cavity if necessary. Excellent. So those are the viscera that we needed to cover. But it's also important to review the peritoneal and fascial specializations in this region as they play such an important role, particularly in stabilization, but will also play a role in terms of a route for neurovasculature to travel. And the most prominent by far is going to be the broad ligament. And this illustration I think could even extend higher up into here. excuse me. So this is going to extend laterally from the uterus to the lateral pelvic walls, and in essence, dividing the true pelvis into anterior and posterior portions. And I really love this BlueLink image. It's one of my favorite ones, as it truly shows the expanse of the broad ligament on this one side. So you can see here, this is going to be the uterus right here. So it's expanding all the way to the lateral wall. There are three major parts of the broad ligament that are continuous, and these are named based on the visceral structure that is most closely related to. The most superior is going to be the mesosalpinx. Salpinx is an ancient trumpet-like instrument and is describing the supposed trumpet shape of the uterine tube, particularly in the infundibulum part. So the mesosalpinx is most closely associated with the uterine tube and is so the most superior portion. So it's any of this peritoneum that's covering the uterine tubes here. You can even see some of that fimbriae on the ends there. The mesopharynx is the smallest portion of the broad ligament. It is going to be the most posteriorly placed as well. That anterior border of the ovary is covered by the mesopharynx. So it's in this general region here. And then all of the rest of this, so the largest, the most inferior portion is going to be the mesometrium portion of the broad ligament. So it's going to be the part that's extending laterally from the uterine body. And the uterine arteries will actually pass between its two peritoneal layers. Another peritoneal ligament is the suspensory ligament of the ovary, which is a very long name, and it's also known by another long name, the infundibulopelvic or IP ligament. So the suspensory ligament is going to extend from the general region of the abdominal aorta and the inferior vena cava to the pole of the ovaries. And the reason it has such a long extent is because it's conducting the gonadal arteries and veins, specifically the ovarian. And it will extend over the external iliac vessels, and the ureter. So it's traveling all the way from kind of the abdominal region down towards the ovaries, and it'll actually be continuous with the mesovarium, which you can kind of see right there. The ovarian ligament, or ligament of the ovary, attaches the lateral portion of the uterus, so this general region here, to the inferior medial portion of the ovary. The ovary is going to be right in this general region. So located posterior but inferior to the uterine tube. All right. You can see that it lies in the broad ligament, so it's very closely associated with the broad ligament, and it's going to be continuous with the round ligament of the uterus, both of which are remnants of the gubernaculum, which were present during the descent of the gonad. Now, we've discussed the round ligament of the uterus in a previous session when we were discussing the inguinal canal. It is typically described as extending from the lateral uterus through the deep inguinal ring, which you can see a bit of that right here, and traverses the inguinal canal and ending in the labium majus, although there are some studies that show a high prevalence of this structure ending just distal to the superficial ring. Nearer to the uterus, which is the portion that we can see right here in this image, contains a notable amount of smooth muscle, but this gradually diminishes more distally and will appear more fibrous or like a collection of adipose tissue the more distal that you get. So the part that's associated with the inguinal canal heading to the labium majus. The transverse cervical or cardinal ligament is a condensation of endopelvic connective tissue, so it is not peritoneum. And this will extend from the cervix, so that's the key here, it's extending from the cervix to the lateral pelvic wall, so it'll be inferior to the broad ligament. So not in this image here, just kind of getting an idea of where it would be located. So, and also of note, not made of peritoneum. So the transverse cervical ligament will radiate with some other ligaments around the cervix providing support. The uterine artery is transmitted or travels adjacent to the base or the bottom of the broad ligament. And it is right at that boundary between where the broad ligament ends and the transverse cervical ligament begins that the ureter travels in close proximity to the uterine artery. So you may hear water under the bridge. The ureter is, as we know, is going to transmit urine, so that's the water, and it will travel under the bridge, which is the uterine artery, right at this level. Excellent, we have come to the summary slide, so thank you for your time and attention here. Please make sure to review and reach out if you have any questions. I hope you have a great rest of your day.